ahead and get started. Welcome to the Data Biz Group. If you are not currently a member, we certainly invite you to join online. This bit.ly short link will get you to the group page, where once you register, you'll get emails when we schedule new events in the future. Feel free to do posting. Generally, we use the hashtag BFWDataBiz unless you've got another hashtag or anything in your presentation you want to use. Okay. I'm going to move on. So if you did miss the Wi-Fi is SMU guest. Our sponsors, my company is InfoNuke. We do infographics and data visualization design, not only on here in the area, but we do it for clients all over the world. SMU, thankfully. Thank you, Leah, for providing us location every month. VisMe is also a sponsor for us, helps pay for the refreshments and the funds at meetup.com. If you're not familiar with VisMe, they're actually out of DC, so they're usually not here to be able to talk about it. But they just released a huge overhaul to their interface, and it's an online design platform. So you can do designs for infographics, presentations, charts, web banners, ads, almost like a mini Illustrator online. You get a blank canvas and you can design. The charts are interactive, so you can actually add the data and it'll build the chart and let you edit the chart. It has a whole bunch of publishing tools, and they just did a whole overhaul to the interface. So it's free to try, so you can welcome to log on and support VisMe for supporting us. In general, our goals for the group, right? Local networking, trying to find people in the area that are interested in data viz, data scientist, infographic design, look at design tools, bring in speakers like Cole this evening, and learn best practices. So if you have any future ideas for events or speakers you'd like to suggest, please send me a note, either my email or just through the meetup site, you can contact me also. I'll break, and we try to make an opportunity for anybody who is currently hiring, looking for designers, data viz, data scientists, that kind of thing. Anybody hiring at the moment, looking for a position for data viz design work? You want to stand up and talk about it real quick?
Sure. Yeah, so my name is Manuel Blades, and I'm a recruiter at Southwest Airlines, and we are engaging in data, trying to become a customer-centric, data-driven organization. And we're standing up a data science team, an advanced analytics team, so looking for a data scientist and a data visualization design.
Okay, excellent. So do you have any cards? If anybody's interested,
you know what?
You can hook up with Manuel.
I'm a recruiter without a card.
Without a card.
Can you believe that?
Send you back.
I brought pen and paper the old-fashioned way.
Anybody else? Okay. The group, I have put up two videos from some prior events up on YouTube. Comment on them, send me notes. I think this is something that people that missed the meetings really appreciate. We've got the one from February, which was the panel from the Dallas Morning News, and then Eric Swain did his Scientist a Storyteller presentation in March, and so both of those are now on YouTube. And I've started basically a channel thread, and we'll just keep adding to it for the ones that we videotaped. Upcoming events. So you guys are probably familiar with Tufty. I just figured out over the weekend that he actually has one of his one-day classes scheduled later in May. So I figured this is the group that if you haven't been to it, you'd be interested in potentially going to his one-day workshop. I've gone to it before. It's worth going for that one day. You get all four copies of his books. He likes to walk around the room and sign the books, even without you looking. That's on the 21st that he'll be in Dallas. So just as information for the group. Let me introduce John in the back corner over here. John Colarotolo. No, I believe that.
Colarotolo
from Collective Net. Yeah. He's going to be graphically recording the presentation tonight. But you know, please tell us about Collective Net and what you guys do.
Sure, I'll be brief. You can ask me questions later. Before I say that, I second the ever touchy thing. I went years ago. It was really cool. And just to like go up to him and have a conversation, yep, ask a question and shake his hand, it's pretty cool. It's like he's, you know, a rock star. Anyway, so at Collective Next, we design and facilitate collaborative workshops for organizations of any size. We help companies solve crazy problems that they're working on, and we help them use the brain power within their organization to solve their own problems. So you can say we're consultants, but we're not like a McKinsey that brings you an answer. We help you find your own answer. And within the the context of a workshop or a session, one of the tools we use is scribing or graphic facilitation. And I'm going to do that over here tonight while we hear Cole from the class. While we hear from Cole give a presentation. So it'll be a mixture of capturing the presentation, and then when you get to Q&A dialogue, I'll just real time capture discussion. If you want to know more, come ask me, but I think that's the decision.
Yep.
Okay, thanks.
And John has volunteered to come do this tonight. It's going to be fantastic. So thank you very much, John. Okay, so our plan for our June meeting is to do a DataViz tool night, meaning I need volunteers, I need you people to volunteer to step up here, plug in, and demo a DataViz tool that you're either familiar with or use. I've only got two people that have volunteered so far. I'd like to get at least five or six to actually make an evening of it, and then I can show a few tools as well. So I need you guys to help make this work out. I'm only talking about like 5 minutes to show what tool that you're familiar with and how you've used it, or how you've seen other people use it, if you've got some examples that you can share. And to sort of make it more of an interactive group event than a single speaker. So through the meetup event, you can send me, I've got cards if you don't have my email address. It's just randy@infonuke.com, it's pretty easy. But I need volunteers to make this event work in June on the 18th, and we're gonna be back at the Dallas site to do that in June.
You said June 18th, right?
Yep.
That's Tuesday, right?
Yes. I think. I don't know off the top of my head.
Thursday, sorry.
Okay. Open it up. Anybody else know of any other events coming up, any other groups meeting that this group may be interested in? Anything you want to announce? No? Good. Moving on. The Big Design Conference will be in September. And I've mentioned this a couple times because early bird registration is a really good deal. Plus, you can use our code DataViz to get an additional 20% off. So if you have thoughts that you're going to go to the Big Dallas Design Conference, now is the time to buy in and save yourself a couple hundred bucks. And then let's bring on Cole. Cole's in town doing a workshop, but she has graciously volunteered to come speak tonight and do her death of pie charts. And I do have a slide about your workshop tomorrow if you want to mention.
Yeah,
talk about your workshop.
What we'll go through tonight is going to be a super condensed overview of content that I typically cover in much more depth in a half day or a full day workshop. And I'm actually doing a public workshop tomorrow morning here in Dallas. So in case you want more and just can't stand to not see what happens in a longer session, there's still a few spots left. And registration will stay open until probably 10 or so tonight, and then I'll go ahead and shut it off. So in the event that you want more and are free tomorrow morning to go to the west side of Dallas, I'll be doing a session there.
And it's from 9 to 12.
Okay. Yeah. And all the info is here. It looks like Randy has a shortcut where
We have a Bitly link to get to that workshop, but that also, thank you, gives us a 10% discount on the workshop price as well, if you guys are interested. Only a couple seats left.
Yeah.
Act fast.
Bye now.
All right, let me give you this and you can plug in. There.
Oh, of course. Right. As soon as I threatened to shut it off. So thank you everybody for coming out tonight. Thank you in particular to Randy for setting this up and hosting and all that good stuff. Thanks to John. I'm super excited to see what he's going to come up with on this magical whiteboard over here. My name is Cole, and I tell stories with data. So I've done that over the past decade and some change at a number of different organizations in a number of different roles, most recently at Google, where I worked on the people analytics team. And people analytics at Google is an analytics team that's embedded in Google's HR organization. So the goal there is to try to ensure that people decisions, so decisions about employees, or future employees are data-driven. So we frequently found ourselves in a situation where we needed to convince somebody to do something using data. And tables and graphs and other types of visuals can be fantastic for doing so when they're done well. So over time, we developed some best practices. And one day I thought, I should share these. And so developed a course on data visualization that I taught at Google for a number of years. And then one day I thought, I should share this stuff further. Being able to communicate effectively with data is not a skill that's needed by Google alone. Rather, it's a skill that pretty much anybody could use to have greater impact in their work life. So 2 years ago, I jumped ship and left Google and have been spending my time since then talking to groups such as you all here today about what I've learned and what I'm learning when it comes to communicating with data. In the specific use case where there is a story you want to tell with the data you want to show. Now, as I mentioned, what we'll look at tonight is a super condensed overview of lessons that are typically covered in a longer session, a half day or a full day workshop. But my hope is that you still leave here with some concrete tips and tricks that you can start using immediately to have greater impact when it comes to communicating with data. For that, we'll jump right in. So in school, we spend a lot of time learning about language and about math. On the language side, we learn how to read, how to write, how to put words together into sentences and into stories. And on the math side, we learn how to make sense of numbers. But it's rare that these two sides are paired. The brain really teaches us how to tell stories with numbers. So one of the things that happens is we rely on our tools to understand best practices. And our tools, unfortunately, let us pretty easily do some kind of crummy stuff. So what we have in front of us here is an example of what I would consider poor data visualization. We've all seen a graph that looks something like this before. There is a story here, but my tool, Excel in this case, doesn't know what that story is. That's where it takes me as the analyst or the communicator of the information to make that story so visually clear to my audience that they can't help but see it, that they can't help but focus on what I want them to see and take away the message I want to impart upon them. So we'll come back to this specific example in a couple of minutes. Before we do so, I want to give you a more specific breakdown of how we'll spend our time together here tonight. So my goal, as I mentioned, is to impart some really practical tips and tricks that you can start using immediately when it comes to communicating with data. We'll talk through five key lessons. We're going to start off by talking about the importance of context, having a really clear understanding of who your audience is and what you need them to know or do before you really start visualizing any data or creating any content. In the second section, we'll talk about some different types of displays and use cases for each. In the third section, we will try to get comfortable identifying clutter, the things that are there but aren't adding informative value to our visuals and stripping those elements away. In the fourth section, we'll continue our conversation on how people see and talk about how we can use things like color and size and the position on the page to draw our audience's attention to where we want them to pay it. And then our final lesson of the evening is on story and really making the data a pivotal point in a story that you want to tell. We've got lots of time for questions at the end, so I'm going to power on through this. If you have any burning questions that come up, feel free to raise those. But otherwise, we'll take Q&A at the end. So our first lesson is about context. And there's one important distinction that I like to draw at this point, and that is the distinction between exploratory analysis and explanatory analysis. So exploratory analysis, you maybe start off with a question or a hypothesis, or maybe you have some new data or some data that you haven't really looked at much before. And it's really that exploration process of looking through the data, figuring out what might be interesting that I can learn from this that somebody else might care about. Once you've identified those interesting things that somebody else might care about, then we move into the explanatory space. And that is where you have something specific you want to tell to somebody specific. It's this latter space that we're living in together here this evening. So when it comes to explanatory analysis, there are a couple of questions that you should be able to really concisely answer before you start visualizing any data, before you start creating content. The first is, who are you communicating to? Who is your audience? It's interesting to me because I think so often we start building a graph or building a communication without ever pausing to give much thought to the person who's going to be on the other end of that. So this is just a reminder to pause and think about who that audience is. And the more specific you can be about who the audience is, the better position you put yourself in for being able to communicate with them. So if you can identify your audience, you can think about what motivates your audience and then frame your communication in terms of those motivating factors. Once you've identified your audience, comes the question of what do you want your audience to know or to do? My view is we should always want our audience to know or do something, and we should be working through our graphs, through our communications, to make that something as crystal clear as possible. It's only after we've answered these first two questions, who is my audience, what do they need to know or do, that then we can turn back to the data to say, now given this scenario, what data do I have on hand that can act as evidence of this case that I want to build? So I want to give us a little bit of practice with the who, what, and how. So in a moment, I'm going to put some context up here of a scenario, have you read through it. We're going to come back to this example after each of the lessons that we cover. So go ahead and give this a read, and then we'll talk about it. The startup has created a product, and you're in the process of figuring out how you're going to price the product. And your team has been tasked with giving a recommendation based on how the competitive products have been priced in the marketplace. And you see you've got a proactive teammate who's already gone and put together the data and is asking for your feedback. So the feedback they're asking for is on this graph that we looked at the beginning. But before we start digging through the details of this, let's back up and think about the context, the who, what, and how. Who might our audience be in this case?
Co-workers.
The boss.
The co-workers.
The boss.
Marketing.
Yeah, whomever has the decision-making power over the pricing. Right? So let's assume that that's the VP of product, and it could be any one of these could be the right audience, right, depending on the situation. What do we want our audience to do?
Buy the product.
See the trend.
Make the right decision.
Yeah, to see the trend, to make the right decision. So yeah, we want to build a common understanding of what's been happening in the marketplace when it comes to how our competitors have been priced over time, and ultimately make a decision based on and using this as one of the inputs. So let's assume in this case we've got some data on our competition and how they've priced over time that we're going to use to create this messaging and to create the visualizations that will go along with it. So like I said, we'll come back to this example after each of the lessons that we talk about so we can see them applied in a specific example. So once you've spent some time, then sort of paused up front to think about the context, who's your audience, what do you need them to know, and what data you have on hand to act as evidence of that case, then comes the question, all right, so I've got some data I want to show. How should I do that in a way that's going to get my message across to my audience? There are a lot of different types of data visualizations out there. The good news is that a handful work for most everyday needs. I, in fact, went through all of my work over the course of the year and categorized every single visual that I made. It was hundreds of visuals, and it fell into only 12 categories, which I found surprising. I thought there would be a much longer tail than that. And these are the 12 categories. And we'll look at a sampling of these. I'm not going to go through all of them. But notice as you look at the screen here, a lot of these are familiar types of visuals. For the most part, it's not anything crazy or out of the ordinary. So So oftentimes when you have some data you want to show, the first sort of things that we think about are tables and graphs. But before we even get there, I want to spend a couple moments on the power of simple text. When you have just one or a couple of numbers that you want to show, think about using the numbers directly, physically writing out the numbers. Something about taking a number or two and putting them in a table or a graph that, beyond potentially being misleading, just causes the numbers themselves to lose some of their own. So if you have just a number or a couple of numbers that you want to communicate, think about using the numbers directly. When you have more data you want to show, typically a table or a graph will be the way to go. One thing to understand is that people interact very differently with these two types of visuals. Tables interact with our verbal system, which means that we read them. When I have a table in front of me, I typically have my index fingers out. I'm reading across rows, I'm reading down columns, I'm comparing values. Tables are great for just that. If you have a mixed audience who's each going to want to look to their own specific line of interest and get the detail. Or if you have many different units of measure, sometimes that can be easier to pull off in a table or in a graph. And I say something next is sometimes considered slightly controversial, which is that if you're giving a live presentation, a table has no place in it. So as soon as you put a table up there, you lose your audience's attention because they start reading the table and looking for things that might be relevant to them. And when that happens, you lose their attention for what you're saying. So if you find yourself reaching for a table in a live presentation, pause and think about what point you're trying to make with the table, because probably there will be a visual that will help you get that across more quickly. Graphs, on the other hand, interact with our visual system. And our visual system is much faster at processing information than our verbal system, which means that a well-designed graph is going to get the information across more quickly than a well-designed table. Let's take a look at a couple types of common graphs. First off, the scatter plot. Scatter plots are great when you have data you want to encode simultaneously along a horizontal X and a vertical Y axis. For example, imagine for a moment that you are a car manufacturer. One thing you might be interested in looking at are how issues and satisfaction sort of interplay. So here on our y-axis, we have things gone wrong, measured in number of issues per thousand. And then along the horizontal axis, we have satisfaction ranging from low to high based on our customer satisfaction survey. We've plotted the prior year average directly on the graph, given our audience a construct to use as they're interpreting the information. So we can see really quickly how this year's models compare to last year's. Can see where we're doing well, can see where there might be areas for concern, and perhaps dig into those more. Another type of common graph is the line graph. So typically the x-axis, the horizontal x-axis on a line graph is some unit of time. Anybody know why that is? Guesses? Quiet bunch. Should I stand up here awkwardly until somebody says something?
Well, you're connecting amounts over time, so time has to be part of the line graph because you're connecting. But that's also the problem.
The key word in what you're saying is connecting. Because these points are physically connected, means we only want to use a line graph when we're plotting continuous data. If you can imagine, if we have categories on our x-axis, we're implying this visual connection between them that probably doesn't make sense. So the rule is, when you're using a line graph, make sure you're plotting continuous data. Oftentimes it's some unit of time, days, months, quarters, years. Let's look at an example line graph. So here is passport control wait time from a US airport. We can see what's happened over time. Note here we also get a sense of the range because the minimum and maximum are plotted. This strategy can work well if you are forecasting something because then you can use the shading to provide a sense of the confidence interval or errors that you're expecting around your point estimate. You always want to think about, is there additional context that's going to be critical to my audience for helping them interpret what I'm putting in front of them? So if you're showing something over time, think about, you know, is there a goal or a target associated with that that we can put on the graph? Or are there similar statistics from the prior year that might help lend context that would help in the interpretation? How many people are familiar with slope graphs? A couple people. They're a little less common, which is strange because they're actually really common. We just don't ever think about them as such. So slope graph is a special case of a line graph where you have just two points in time. Probably the easiest way to explain is by looking at a specific example. So let me just quickly talk through what we're looking at here. So what we've plotted here is employee feedback. Which we've got from our annual employee survey. We can see what happened in 2014, last year, compared to this year. And the cool thing about a slope graph is that you get a lot of information in a pretty intuitive way, pretty easily and quickly. We get the rank ordering of how we fared across the different categories last year, as well as this year. The coolest thing from my perspective is we also get this sense of change visually shown, without ever having to talk about or use the words percent change or rate of change. Now, it's implicit via the slope of the line. Whether a slope graph will work in your situation depends on the actual layout of your data. If you have a lot of crisscrossing lines in a really tight space, sometimes that isn't ideal for a slope graph. Though on occasion, you can still make it work by strategically emphasizing or de-emphasizing some of the components. Talk a little bit more about strategies like that in a bit. So remember, with line graphs, the rule is you must be plotting continuous data. When it's categorical data you've got, a bar chart is your very best friend. I think sometimes we avoid bar charts because they're common. My view is that's the wrong approach. We should use them and use them frequently because they're common. It means less of a learning curve for our audience for getting at the information. Right, so they're not using a brain power to try to figure out how do I read this graph. They already know how to read the graph. So instead, they're using their brain power to figure out what information can I take out of it. Bar charts are also really easy for our eyes to read. What our eyes are doing are comparing the endpoints of the bars relative to the axis. So it's easy to see quickly which category is the biggest, which is the smallest, also the incremental difference between categories. Now, there are several types of bar charts. This is your sort of standard vertical bar chart or column chart. It's also the horizontal bar chart. Great use case here is if my category names are very long. Allows me to orient my text from left to right, as your audience probably reads. Makes your graph legible for your audience, which is just a nice thing to do, okay? And we're going to keep coming back to audience again and again and again throughout our short time together here tonight, because everything we're doing when it comes to communicating with data is for that audience. So I keep that person in mind throughout the design process. And in general, try to identify anything that's going to feel like work to your audience and take that work upon yourselves as the designers of the information so that to your audience it just feels easy. Back on the topic of bar charts, another common type is the stacked bar chart. So good use case here is if I want to compare totals across different categories, and then within a given category, I want some understanding of the subcomponent pieces. Less useful, though, when we start comparing those subcomponent pieces across categories, because as soon as we get past this first series, we no longer have a consistent baseline to use to compare. It's just a harder comparison for our eyes to make. The exception would be when you've got the 100% stacked bar. Because then you get your consistent baseline along the bottom as well as along the top. Or if we flip it on its side to a horizontal 100% stacked, you get a consistent baseline on the left-hand side allowing you to read from left to right, or on the right-hand side allowing you to read from right to left. So because of that setup, horizontal 100% bar charts can be great for visualizing survey data collected on a Likert scale, where you've got something ranging from, you know, something like strongly disagree to strongly agree. So you take advantage of the fact that there's negative connotation on the left. You can read, you know, how we're doing when it comes to the people dissatisfied, and the positive connotation on the right, and read that from rightwards left. While we're on the topic of bar charts, let's quickly look at an example from the media. So for this one, we have to imagine ourselves back in the fall of 2012. We're looking forward to 2013 to say what's going to happen when the Bush tax cuts expire. On the left-hand side, we have what the top tax rate is today at 35%. On the right-hand side, what it will go to on January 1st at 39.6%. Anybody see any issues?
It didn't start at zero.
It doesn't start at zero. This number that's small and on the right, maybe on purpose, I'm not sure, is not zero, but rather 34. Which really means these bars should continue down to, I don't know, maybe past the floor even. And you can imagine if they were to do so, how that relative difference between them looks a whole lot different than is portrayed here. In fact, the way this is graphed is a 460% visual increase compared with an actual increase of 13%. The rule here is bar charts must have a zero baseline. Because of the way our eyes are comparing the endpoints relative to the baseline, you actually need the context of a whole bar there in order to be able to do that accurately. I also sometimes see, so here we've sort of chopped off the bottom of the graph. I've also seen where the middle is chopped off, where you know we've got an axis like this that maybe has some zigzag lines in it, and part of it is omitted. You can't do that. It falls victim to the same issue we have here, which is when you manipulate that scale, all of a sudden the comparison you're trying to make visually is no longer valid. Now, when I tend to see that done is usually when we're trying to show big differences, differences in magnitude between a really small number and a really big number, and you want to be able to show that all together. So one alternative when that's the case is the square area graph. So if you can imagine with a bar chart, you only get height or width, depending on whether it's a vertical or a horizontal bar chart. With a square, you get both height and width, which allows you to compare numbers of very different magnitudes in a more compact space. So here in this example I have up in front of you, we can see this whole block is US adults, 247 million. The dark gray represents online adults. And then this tiny square at the bottom right here are health app users. So you can sort of see visually how much that makes up of those different populations. So, yeah, question.
I was going to say, don't you think though of having to start stuff at zero for a bar chart that there are exceptions to that? If you're showing, I'm thinking financially big financial numbers where you're talking gazillions of dollars,
yeah,
and there's just a little bit of difference between the two, but that difference is extremely significant.
Yeah, and if the difference is over time, then we can plot it with a line graph where we can get away.
Right, but if you just have two bars, but the difference between it is
not
like
bars.
$10,000 over a 10 million.
Yeah, and then are you imagining something over time?
Now, I have clients that have, you know, a very slight difference in two bars, one last year and this year.
Right, so but then you're looking at time. So that's the critical component. With time,
right,
you can plot it with a line graph where you can get away with zooming.
Okay. What if it wasn't across time? So it's like two divisions of a...
You don't want to zoom in on a bar. There, the actual numbers might be more meaningful, or there might be a statistic from that, right, percent difference or something else that might make that more meaningful.
I have to battle with a client, so I was just wondering.
Okay.
About
that. Yeah, I would think about what is the main thing they're trying to say, right? If this is a major difference, but it seems small when you plot it in bars, then bars aren't going to be the right way to show it. And maybe then it's thinking about flipping it around to say the difference between them. Do other people have ideas? Yeah.
I think the issue here is that you've got some people that want to make it look more different than it is.
Yeah.
In terms
but
of client.
Yeah.
And I mean, there are lies
yeah,
and statistical
yeah,
and visual lies.
Yeah. Yeah. Which
if
we think about
they know exactly what they're doing.
Yeah.
From an accuracy standpoint, that difference number is really what you need to plot from a visualization and communicating what's going on. But that's not necessarily what your client wants
but
to
I,
demonstrate.
But I'm still, I mean, I kind of agree with you that you really need to have a consistency,
yeah,
and start with zero. But I also feel like this bar chart, chopping up the zero and bringing it to just show the difference is a good visualization sometimes. So I kind of agree, like, you know, I would have done it.
It may allow you to see something that you wouldn't have seen before, but it's distorting the actual data. So in the Fox News example,
you could reach the wrong decision.
Exactly. It's risky territory. And we're sort of bordering with our questions on this idea of ethics in data visualization. So the corollary of your statistics, damn statistics, I always mess that one up, is the golden rule of data visualization, which is don't lie with data visualization. But if that in itself isn't sort of a guiding principle enough, it's also really dangerous territory, because all it takes is the one discerning audience member that looks at that graph we had up there before and says, you don't start at zero, you're totally misrepresenting the comparison here, and any credibility you had gets thrown out the window. So don't paint a one-sided story or manipulate the data to show what you want it to show, because a discerning audience will poke holes in that, and the risks can be big. Yeah, risks of poor decisions being made because of a bad interpretation of data. All right, let's keep going. So when we look at these dozen types of visuals, there is one very common visual that is absent from this list.
Is it the title of today's presentation?
Pie charts. Where are the pie charts? So let's take a look at a pie chart. This one in particular shows supplier market share across four suppliers, A, B, C, and D. If I had to ask you, or if I were asking you a simple question based on this data, which supplier makes up the biggest share of the market, which one would you say?
You need data labels.
Which one looks biggest?
A.
B looks biggest, but it's...
You have a 3D on there, too.
Yeah, all right, so you guys are jumping way ahead, which is fine. Bear with me for one more question. Okay, so supplier B, I'm going to put out there, looks the biggest, right? It does. Maybe there's something fishy going on. Put that in the back of your head for a minute, though. Supplier B looks biggest. If you had to put a percentage on it, how much does supplier B make up of the total market? What percent might you estimate?
One third.
One third,
33. Less than a third.
Maybe something like that, right? Yeah, you guys are a skeptical audience. Sometimes I hear people go, 40%, 45%. Okay, so clearly you can tell, but you knew already. You kind of had some hints that pie charts were not going to be on my favorite list. But there's something fishy going on here, and that is that supplier B, which looks the biggest, it does, at 31%, is actually smaller than supplier A above it that looks smaller. So what do we have going on here?
Perspective.
Yeah, there's a few things going on here. The worst offender of which is the 3D and this tilting perspective, making the top of the pie appear farther away, the smaller than it actually is, the bottom appear closer, and that's bigger than it actually is. There aren't a lot of hard and fast rules when it comes to data visualization. It sits at this sort of fun intersection between art and science. But there are some rules. As we saw a moment ago, bar charts must have a zero baseline. I'll introduce another rule now, which is never ever use 3D. Got it? The only exception is you're actually plotting a third dimension, and even then it gets really hairy really quickly, and never for something like this. Here we're adding noise, we're adding clutter, we're adding a lot of crud, and we're actually making our data harder for our audience to get at. The other thing we have going on here is that people's eyes have a hard time ascribing quantitative value to two-dimensional space. Said more simply, pie charts are hard for people to read. Our eyes don't do a good job of comparing angles and areas, which is what we're asking our audience to do here. So I'd say, okay, that's fine. Let's say I have some data that looks like this. How should I show it? So I'd say if you're absolutely married to the idea of a pie chart, let's at least improve the pie chart. Here I've flattened it. I've taken away the 3D and that tilting perspective that was distorting the values. Taken away the differences in color that weren't meaningful. I've ordered the segments starting with the largest at the top left and working clockwise around the pie from largest to smallest. Creates a construct for my audience to use as they're interpreting the information. Also labeled the segments directly, both with the numeric value, so there's no question as to what that is, as well as the category name, reducing that work of going back and forth between the legend and the data. But I'd also encourage you to think about not a pie chart. So here's the same data organized as a horizontal bar chart. we can see conclusively, very quickly, that supplier A is the biggest, and also how much incrementally larger it is than supplier B, and so on and so forth. And we lose one thing with this transition from pie to not a pie, which is this idea of there being a whole, and thus pieces of a whole. I've tried to show that's the case here by putting a total of 100% at the bottom. It's not a perfect solution, but it's one option to consider. And what I like to encourage is if you find yourself reaching for a pie chart, just pause and ask yourself why. If you can answer that question, you've put enough thought into it to use the pie chart. But it shouldn't be one of the first visuals that we reach for because of some of the interpretation challenges that we've talked about. All right, so as I mentioned, this is just a sampling. In any case, when you're trying to figure out what sort of graph should I use or what sort of visual should I use, the answer is always the same. And that is whatever is going to be easiest for your audience to read. There's a great way to test that, which is just create your visual and hand it to a friend or colleague and have them talk you through their thought process. Where they pay attention, what questions they have, can be really useful for understanding whether the visual you've created is serving its intended purpose, or if not, give you ideas on where to iterate. So let's take a look back now at the example that we started working our way through. So remember, you work for this startup who's getting ready to launch a product, and you're trying to help inform the pricing of that product. And your teammate came to you with this lovely graph. So note the headline at the top. Price has declined for all products on the market since the launch of product C in 2010. So it's something to keep in the back of our heads as we start looking at what we've got going on here. Now, this graph is actually hard to look at because there are so many different colors, it's almost impossible to concentrate on anything to figure out what's going on or to look and see what the trends are. So go through a couple iterations of this. Let's start by stripping out that distracting color. And notice how just doing that makes it easier to see what's happening trend-wise for each of the products over time. Now remember that initial headline said something about 2010 forward. So let's focus just on 2010 forward for a second. So we see clear decreases in product A, product B since 2010, but we're not seeing that really in the products that came to market since then. So we're probably going to want to revisit that headline. Now, if you've been looking at this while I have it up here and thinking we should be using a line graph, we're looking at time, that's probably a wise decision. And so now with this view, it's easy to see the trend for a given product over time, but if we're interested in what's going on across products at a given point in time, that's harder here. We can solve that by aligning everything to a common baseline. Make it so we can compare both what's happening for a given product over time and also at a given point of time to see what's happening across the products. So we're not done yet, we'll keep coming back to this one, but in the meantime, I want to shift gears entirely and talk for a bit about clutter. So if you picture a blank page or a blank screen, every single element you allow onto the page or screen takes a cognitive load on the part of our audience, takes some brain power to process, which means that we want to take a discerning look at the elements that we allow onto our page or our screen and strip away anything that isn't adding informative value or isn't adding enough informative value to make up for its presence. So as part of our conversation on clutter, I'll introduce the Gestalt principles of visual perception. The Gestalt School of Psychology set out in the early 1900s to understand how individuals perceive order in the world around them. What they came away with are the principles of visual perception, still regarded today as how individuals interact with visual stimuli. Talk about them here because of some of the direct applications on our tables and our graphs. First principle is proximity. Tend to think of objects that are physically close together as belonging to part of a group. We can leverage this principle in tables. So in the example at the top, simply by virtue of differentiating the spacing between the dots, your eyes drawn either across the rows in the first case or down the columns in the second case. Next principle is similarity. Tend to think of objects that are similar color, similar size, similar shape, similar orientation as belonging to part of a group. So again, we can leverage this in tables. Use it to draw our audience's attention in the direction we want them to focus. Third principle is enclosure. Tend to think of objects that are physically enclosed together as belonging to part of a group. Note, it doesn't take a very strong enclosure to do this, like background shading is often enough. One way we can leverage the enclosure principle is to draw our audience's attention to part of our visual. The next principle is closure. So it's interesting to me. It says people like things to be ordinary and fit in the constructs that are already in our heads. So most people, when faced with these first two visually opposing stimuli, see a square with a center missing, or similarly a circle with a piece missing. So some of what the principles allow us to do are just question some of the things that our graphing applications have historically done for us. Heavy borders, dark background shading, we can strip those elements away, and our graph still appears as part of a whole, and our data stands out more. Next principle is continuity. This one's similar to closure. It says if I take the objects in the first panel and I pull them apart, most people will expect to see what's shown in the second panel, whereas it could as easily be what's shown in the third. So I like to draw continuous lines even where they may not explicitly exist. So you can use this to start playing around, stripping things out of our visuals and seeing whether or not we lose anything. So here's the example at the top, taking out the y-axis line altogether. Your eye actually still sees it because of the consistent white space between the text and the data. And as we saw in the previous case, the more things we strip away, the more our data stands out. Final property that we'll talk about tonight is the connection property. The connective property has a stronger associative value than similar color, similar shape. It's not typically stronger than enclosure, but that one depends on the relative strength of the connection and the enclosure. So you can sort of play with that through thickness and darkness of lines to get the right sense of visual hierarchy that you're after. One way we use the connective property frequently is in line graphs, to help our eyes make sense out of what is sometimes a whole lot of data. So we got a little theoretical there. Let's ground this back in a more practical example. So back looking at our product pricing over time, if you take a look at this graph now with your clutter lens on, what can we get rid of?
Periods
and double zeros. Yes. Trailing zeros on my y-axis label carry no informative value and yet make the numbers look more complicated than they are. Get rid of them. What else?
Dollar
signs. And dollar signs are one of those dollars percents that you could argue they're redundant, right, because they appear multiple times, but they actually help with the interpretation of the number. So there's some things that even if they feel redundant, should be included each time to help with the interpretation. Dollar signs, percent signs, commas in large numbers would fall into those. Good thinking, but I think those we may want to preserve.
The markers,
yeah, all these data markers. Remember, every single element we add creates cognitive burden. So here we're creating a whole lot of cognitive burden for no additional information. It's not to say never use data markers, but to say use them for a purpose and with a purpose, not because their inclusion is your graphing application's default. What else can we get rid of? Or what else is bothersome?
Tick marks.
Yeah, tick marks are bothersome. Yeah.
It's not necessarily an issue on this one, but what about color blindness?
Great question. We can talk about that.
Because from a colorblindness standpoint, the data markers could actually be important.
I'll argue that they still won't be, but only because we're going to look at another solution that'll address that. Let's pause for a moment on color, though. So we'll see more examples of color as we go through this. But one important consideration when you are figuring out how to use color in your data visualizations is colorblindness. So roughly 8% of men and 0.5% of women are colorblind, which typically manifests itself as difficulty in distinguishing between shades of red and shades of green. So depending on how we're looking at this, the shades of red and green may be hard to tell apart from each other. It means in general you want to try not to use shades of red and shades of green together, or have some sort of additional visual cue there so you're not inadvertently disenfranchising part of your audience. More generally, you want to think about using color never to make something colorful, but when used sparingly, color is your most strategic tool for drawing your audience's attention. Keep that thought in your head because we'll come back to it. Back on this though, other thoughts of things we can get rid of or that are annoying? Yes?
The years being at an angle and also not centered under the data points drives me crazy.
Yeah, it drives me crazy too. So studies have shown diagonal text is about 40% slower to read than horizontal text. Vertical text, by the way, is even slower. So if efficiency of getting your information across is a concern, which it should be, aim to always have horizontal text.
Two-digit year, maybe?
I'm sorry?
Two-digit year?
Yeah, and here we've got the space, so it's weird that they were diagonal in the first place, so we can fix that.
You can see all the grid lines, borders, tick marks, all that stuff.
Yeah, a lot of it can go. What about, how's it feel going back and forth between the legend and the data?
There's plenty of room on there to label those lines.
Yeah. This is one of those things that feels like work to our audience. You have to do a bit of bouncing back and forth between the legend and the data to figure out what you're looking at. That's the kind of work we want to take upon ourselves as the designers of the information so that our audience doesn't have to work. So the risk that we run when we're asking our audience to do work to get at our data visualization or at our information is they decide they don't want to put forth the effort, at which point we've lost our ability to communicate with them. So let's take a look at what happens when we actually make some of these changes. Let's get rid of chart border and grid lines. It's always amazing to me how much those two steps alone do in terms of making my data stand out more. Next, I'm going to get rid of all those data markers. In the next step, I'll clean up my axis. So I'm going to drop the trailing zeros from the y-axis labels. I'll change the year so they appear horizontally on the x-axis. I'm also going to make it so the tick marks align the way that they should. That gets us here. And now notice how that, since we've gotten rid of a lot of the things that are adding cognitive burden, that work of going back and forth between the legend and the data is almost more obvious than it was before. So here we can leverage the Gestalt principle of proximity. Put the data labels right next to the data they describe. While we're leveraging proximity, let's think about also leveraging similarity. Make the data labels the same color as the data they describe. It's just another visual cue to our audience that says, these pieces of information are related. So we're moving in the right direction. We're not done yet. But before we keep playing with that one, I want to talk for a bit more about how people see. This is a super simplified picture of how we see. On the left-hand side, you have light reflecting off a stimulus. This gets captured by our eyes. We don't fully see with our eyes. Rather, our eyes act like little cameras, take pictures of the world around us, and pass those pictures, the electrical currents, on to our brain. And it's what happens in our brain that we think of as visual perception. Now, in the brain, there are a few types of memory that are important to understand as we are designing data visualizations. We're going to talk about one of those tonight, which is iconic memory. People heard this term before, iconic memory. So iconic memory is super short-term. It's shorter than short-term memory, and information stays there for fractions of a second before it gets forwarded onto our short-term memory. The cool thing about iconic memory is that it's tuned to a specific set of what we call pre-attentive attributes, which are huge tools in our designer tool belts. So let's actually do a little exercise on those. So in a moment, I'm gonna put a bunch of numbers up on the screen. What I'd like you all to do, as fast as you can, is count the number of fives that you see. If I got it, you're gonna count the fives. When you know the answer, shout it out. It is a race, and you would like to win. Ready, set, go!
Five, six.
The correct answer is six. That was kind of tough though, right? Not technically difficult, but you have to read through these four lines of text, look for five, which is kind of a complicated shape. Watch what happens though if we make just one tiny change. And I'm gonna do that again for emphasis. You don't have time to think, don't have time to blink, and suddenly there are six fives in front of you. This is so apparent so quickly because I'm leveraging your iconic memory, using the pre-attentive attribute of color, in this case, to make the fives the one thing that stand out as distinct from the rest. And this is hugely critical because what this tells us is our pre-attentive attributes, if we use them wisely, can help enable us to get our audience to see what we want them to see before they even know they're seeing it. Here are the attributes. I won't read through all of these, but notice as your eye scans across the screen how it's just drawn to the one item within each box that looks different. You don't really have to devote any conscious thought to finding it. We can categorize pre-attentive attributes, note I'm doing so here, through the pre-attentive attribute of color, into four categories. In blue, we have pre-attentive attributes of form. In green, pre-attentive attributes of color, spatial position, motion. One thing to understand about the attributes is that people tend to associate quantitative values with some, but not others. For example, most people consider a long line to represent a greater value than a short line. It's one of the reasons that reading bar charts is intuitive for us. But we don't think of color, for example, in the same way. If I ask you which is greater, purple or blue, it's not really a meaningful question. And this is important because it tells us which of the attributes can be used to encode quantitative information and which should be used as categorical differentiators. Let's take a look at some pretty attentive attributes in action. First, with some text. So here is a big block of text. You do not need to read this big block of text. But imagine if you were to. That's a lot to process, right? You have to, it's kind of the count the fives example all over again, where you have to put on this lens of what's important or interesting, what should I pay attention to? Maybe read through it again to put the important or interesting things back in context of the rest of something. Check out what happens, though, as we start using pre-attentive attributes selectively on the text. And notice as we do how your eye is drawn with differing strength to the different attributes. Leverage bold, italics, color, size, capital letters, outline, underline, separate spatially. And now check out what happens when we use multiple pre-attentive attributes together. Suddenly we have something that is scannable. Studies have shown we have on the order of 3 to 8 seconds with our audience, during which time they're deciding whether they're going to continue to look at what we've put in front of them or move on to the next thing. If we've used our pre-attentive attributes well, even if we only get that first 3 to 8 seconds, we've gotten our main point across. So pre-attentive attributes are hugely useful at doing two things. The first is drawing our audience's attention to where we want them to look. And the second is creating this sense of visual hierarchy on the page that says to our audience, this is most important, pay attention here first. This is next most important, pay attention here next, and so on and so forth. So pre-attentive attributes, as you can imagine, are also very useful in data visualization. So here's a graph showing our results for our annual customer survey. We can see how we did across a number of dimensions. Without any other visual cues, I'm left to process all of this information. If I'm an analyst and I've already looked at this data and I have a message I want to impart, I don't want you forming your own conclusions. I want to be able to tell you what to pay attention to. So in that case, we can pair pre-attentive attributes with some text and draw your attention very quickly to one part of the story. So let's pause and celebrate success. Or we can use this same broad strategy to tell a completely different side of the story, draw your attention to a different side of the story. This strategy can be really useful, by the way, if you have the benefit of being in a live presentation where you're walking your audience through. So you can set up the data once and then use pre-attentive attributes to highlight the portions you're talking about as you're talking about them. So your audience always knows where to be looking for evidence of what you're saying. So let's look now back to the example we've been working our way through. So one of the things I like to start by doing is pushing everything to the background. So that forces me to make explicit decisions about what I draw forward or what I bring attention to. So remember that initial headline was about the launch of product C in 2010 and a decline since then. So if we highlight the launch in 2010, we saw a decline in existing products since then, which may be something interesting. But with this layout more broadly, we can see that with the launch of a product in this marketplace, we tend to see a price increase followed by an eventual decline. And if we look at our most recent data point, prices have converged to a pretty tight band when we think of how they've been historically. Note how your attention just goes where it's meant to go because of the strategic use of pre-attentive attributes here. Now, any of these might be the right point of emphasis, depending on the story we want to tell. Which brings me to our final lesson of the evening on story. And when I'm thinking story, I'm thinking like full-on children's book story. For example, Little Red Riding Hood. Let's actually do a little exercise here. Let's just take 30 seconds, and you can stare up at this screen, or you can close your eyes, and I would like you to recall for yourself the story of Little Red Riding Hood, thinking specifically about the plot, the twists, and the ending. All right? 30 seconds, and we'll talk about why this is relevant. All right, how folks doing? Did you come up with maybe the like 60 to 80% version? Nobody came up with anything? Come on, humor me. You guys know the story of Little Red Riding Hood? Okay, people are nodding and smiling, but nobody's gonna stick their hand up for fear of what might happen next. All right, so I'll tell you the version that resides in my head. So Little Red Riding Hood sets off to go to Grandma's. I think Grandma's maybe sick. She has a basket of goodies. Encounters a wolf along the way. They have a little exchange. And Wolf runs ahead and eats Grandma, dresses up in her clothing. Red arrives, and they have a series of questions that they go through, right? What questions does the wolf ask, or does Red Riding Hood ask the wolf?
Big teeth you have.
Yes, oh, Grandma, what big eyes you have, what big nose you have, what big teeth you have. What happens then?
Better to eat you with.
And then what?
Eat you.
In some versions, yeah. So I think the original Grimm's version, Red Riding Hood gets eaten, and then what happens?
The hunter comes in, kills the wolf, and frees her.
Yeah, guy with an axe shows up, chops the wolf in half, out comes Little Red Riding Hood, out comes Grandma, everybody's happy, except probably the wolf, right? So what in the world relevance could Little Red Riding Hood have with what we're talking about here tonight? For me, it's evidence of a couple of things. First is the power of repetition. When you consider that you probably have heard that story a number of times, perhaps told that story a number of times, or read that story a number of times, there's something that happens with that repetition of hearing and saying and reading that helps cement things into our long-term memory. The other cool thing we have going on with Little Red Riding Hood is this sort of magical combination of plot and twists and ending that helps embed things in our memory in a way that we can then later recall and retell to somebody else. So when I think about how we can use both of these concepts of storytelling when it comes to the stories we want to tell with our data so that we can get them to stick with our audience and stick with our audience in a way that they can later retell to somebody else. So one critical component of stories is words. There are some words that have to be there. Every graph needs a title, every axis needs a title. There are no exceptions, or the one exception with axis titles. If your x-axis is January, February, March, April, you probably don't need to say months of the year. You probably do need to make it clear what year it is. Any other axis needs a title. Don't assume that two different people looking at the same data visualization are going to walk away with the same conclusion, which means if there is a conclusion you want your audience to reach, you need to state it in words and use what we know about creative attributes to make those words stand out. Make them big, make them bold, put them in high priority places on the page like the top. Speaking of which, stories have words, annotate with text. That title bar in PowerPoint is precious real estate, or this could be the title, the section titles in your report. Yet so often we use it for descriptive titles. Think about using that space for active titles. If there is a key takeaway, put it there so your audience doesn't miss it. So an example of words used wisely. This is a visualization done by David McCandless in the UK. Peak breakup times according to Facebook status updates. So we follow it over the course of the year. We have some spikes around spring break, Fool's Day. Mondays, for some reason, are popular for breakups. Not sure what sort of debauchery happens over the weekend. Gentle rise and fall over summer holiday. And then this massive uptick leading up to the holidays. And I was like, stress of Christmas shopping or family or what. But then a dramatic drop off at Christmas, because breaking up with somebody then would just be kind of mean. And note how, in this case, just a few choice words make the information so much more quickly accessible than it otherwise would be. So when it comes to the stories we want to tell with our data, we want to think about this combination of plot and twists and ending. So the plot is, what does our audience need to know to put them sort of on level ground to be ready for what we're going to tell them? Then the twists, what's interesting about the data and what it shows? By the way, if there isn't anything interesting about the data, don't show the data. You run the risk of losing your audience's attention for when you do have something interesting to say with it. So don't let it distract from your message. And then finally, the ending. What do you want your audience to do? Let's look back one more time to this example we've been working our way through. So let's start off by putting the words that have to be there. Pick your chart title, axis labels, and now let's think about how we want to lead our audience through the story, what progression we want to tell them. So let's assume that I have 5 minutes on a meeting agenda to give you into my team's work. So I might start off by setting the stage, right? 5 minutes, my goal is twofold. First, I want to give everybody a common understanding of how prices have changed over time in the competitive landscape. And then secondly, we're going to use this knowledge to inform the pricing of our product. To that end, I'm going to make a specific recommendation. Now, if we take a look at what's happened over time, now before I put any data up here, let me talk to you about what I'm going to put up here. On our y-axis is average retail price. On our x-axis is time, starting with 2008 at the left and going to 2014 at the right. Products A and B were both launched in 2008, price points of 360 and more. They've followed a similar trajectory over time, with product B always being priced slightly lower than A. They're pretty narrow though in 2014, priced at 260 and 250 respectively. But something interesting has happened. There have been new products that have come onto the marketplace, and all of them have really undercut the pricing of these existing products. But the prices of all have increased since their respective launches. And in general, what we tend to see in this space after the launch of a product is an initial price increase followed by an eventual decline. And at our most recent data point, 2014, prices have converged to a relatively narrow range when we look at the breadth going back historically. Average of 223, ranging from 180 to 260. Therefore, my recommendation is that we price slightly below that average in the $150 to $200 range. My story to my audience might sound something like this. And when you consider how far we've come from that initial visual that our teammate asked for feedback on, we've made a transition from showing data to telling a story with data. And that's where it takes applying all of the things that we've covered tonight. Building a robust understanding of the context, choosing an appropriate visual display, identifying and eliminating clutter, drawing attention to where you want your audience to focus, and telling a story. So with that, we're done. Questions?
I thought we were going to translate this whole thing to a pie chart.
Just on that final chart that you show, one adjustment that might give more information would be to normalize all the prices from years since launch.
Yeah, that would be one way to line them up, right? Would be to start at time zero and have them all. And it really depends what we're trying to answer and what we're trying to show. That's my number one takeaway tonight and is the answer to most questions you will ask, which is pause and think about the audience. Think about what it is they're meant to know. Because from there, you can back into what sort of design choices or what sort of visuals are going to make sense. But yeah, that's absolutely could be another way to look at it. Other questions?
Who do you think does graphics and charts well as far as, you know, online resources or
publications? Yeah, great resources for good. And I'll open this up to the group because there are so many good sources of things out there. The New York Times, The Economist, I see lots of good charts for both of those. Randy, what do you think? What are some of your top? 538 has been doing a lot
Nate's
of really
group,
great stuff lately. Other sources of good data viz?
Are we not going to give a shout out to the Dallas Morning News guys?
Sure.
Say,
yeah.
Morning News.
They pitched to us a couple months ago.
So yeah, 538 is one I would definitely check out if you're not familiar. There are a lot of great blogs out there, and a lot of it's just being a discerning, like trust your gut. If something doesn't feel quite right, I think oftentimes we as the audience blame ourselves of like, oh, it's just more complicated, I don't understand it, when really it comes back to faulty design. So your eye knows when you see things that are good or that are less effective. So just take note of when you see something that looks good, why is it good, and what about it's effective.
What other people you follow online?
Oh, I follow lots. Yeah, some of my favorites. My must-read, Nathan Yao, anything he posted. He writes Flowing Data. Sorry, it's the end of a long day for me, too. I'm trying to make my brain work. There's a big list. I can, if you go on my site, they're listed there. Alberto Cairo, who does the functional art, posts a lot of great stuff. John Schwabish does policybiz.com, and he also actually runs a site called Help Me Biz.
Help Me Biz.
Where if you're interested in getting feedback on something, you can post it, you can send it to him, and he'll post it on the site where you can get feedback from people. It's also, there's a really great archive going from people who have submitted questions and visuals in the past. So if you're looking for inspiration, that can be a good place.
Yeah. Having worked at Google and talking about audiences and dealing with different audiences, do you have any best practices for the finance person, the executives, the salespeople, things that you find in different audiences?
Yeah, that's a great question, because that was one of the challenges that we were constantly facing, is your audiences would be so varied sometimes. You know, on the one end of the spectrum, we'd have engineers wanting excruciating levels of detail in some cases, and then the other end of that would be, you know, like managers on the sales team just wanting to know how should we act on this, what should we do. So you can think about, if you're dealing with widely disparate audiences like that, if it makes sense, or if there's a way to communicate to them separately, because then you put yourself in a position for success where you can take the needs of your audience into account and not try to create something that's going to meet everybody's needs, which is inevitably really challenging. But when that doesn't make sense, then you're sort of stuck trying to figure out, okay, then how do I form a communication that's going to work for these different audiences? And one of the things that we would find ourselves doing would be, you tell the high-level story, but have the detail there either if you need it or so folks can chase after it if they want to. Now, practically, it's if you're giving a live presentation, one way to do it would be have your overarching story, and then if you can anticipate where people may have questions or want more details, you can have a little hyperlink that allows you to get to a page or pages back in the appendix to be able to cover that. So we only have to go into it if the question gets raised or if more detail is desired, but it doesn't sort of distract from the main story. Some of the strategies that we employ.
Other questions?
The square area chart that you showed earlier, I don't see those very often, and it really strikes me as almost equivalent to the pie chart, because it's dealing largely with area. Now, I know there's angles on the pie chart. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's a fair point, and they're definitely less common. I can think of a handful of cases. The one that we looked at up here was one of them. Another example where I used that type of graph was looking at recruiter statistics, where you had, you know, you gave, phone screened 1,000 candidates, say, and of that you invited 30 on site, just making up numbers, and of those you extended 3 offers, and of those one of them accepted. So to be able to show just sort of the magnitude of how big that 1,000 is, and then highlight each of those subgroups one at a time, I agree that you run into, anytime you're using area, you run into some of the same things that we talked about with pie charts, which is just that people's eyes aren't good at that. So in the example that we had up, and anytime you do those, you want to have some of the grid, you want to have the grid lines there, because people tend to underestimate area. So without those, your small piece looks, yeah, not even exactly like it should. They're definitely a less common one, and I agree, fall victim to some of the things, though not to quite as bad of an extent as the pie chart. But it's a fair point. Yeah.
And one other thing, colorblindness was mentioned earlier. Did you really go back and cover that?
You know, briefly. But the colorblindness, so you typically want to try to avoid using shades of red and shades of green together. As you saw through a lot of the examples that we looked at here, I tend to work in shades of gray and use blue as my sparing call-out color. Blue I like because you avoid the colorblind issue. It prints well in black and white, if that's a concern. But with colorblindness, the main thing you want to avoid is red and green together. Or if you are showing them together, then you want to have some sort of additional visual cues there so that they can still be told apart by people who can't see the red-green differential. Or sometimes I've seen where it's a light shade of green and a dark shade of red, or vice versa. Or if you're emphasizing, you're using red and green to show the good and the bad, you can always think of, you know, could I show the good and then sequentially the bad, so that you're not forcing people to try to look for both at the same time. Yeah.
So on that note, would it be wise to use different style, light style, like dotted and like dashed?
The challenge that you get into pretty quickly when you start messing with the actual lines, so yeah, if you create dotted lines, so that basically, we talked about clutter, right? Every single element adds clutter. If you take a single solid line and break it into 20 pieces, depending on how it's laid out, those 20 pieces can feel much more cluttered than the single line. So I don't recommend different line types like that as a method for categorization. Now that said, there are some cases where the connotation you get with a dotted line can be very useful. For example, there's less certainty sort of associated when you've got a dotted line. So if you're showing actual data and then a forecast, it can be great to show the actual data as a solid line and then the forecast as a dotted line, because then you build in some of that intuitive sort of less certainty, which can help in interpretation.
Do you pick up that same kind of feeling of clutter if you use different line weights? So if, like, one was a half point versus 3-point line?
I think there it's less about clutter and more about emphasizing. So that's the thickness of lines is one way to draw more attention to one or the other. So yeah, when it's thinking about how do you use these things to strategically de-emphasize some things and emphasize other things, that can work. No, from a clutter standpoint, you don't get that sort of increased clutter. The exception would be if you have a lot of really thick lines, because then that can just feel sort of overbearing. But test it out, try it on people. And oftentimes looking at your visual is really helpful, or I'll do what I call the optometrist approach, where I'll create sort of, I've got the latest and greatest graph, and then I make a copy of it, and I make one minor change so that I can see them both side by side, and keep doing that iteration where you've always got your latest and greatest copy so you can go back to it if your change screws it up. But oftentimes being able to see two options side by side makes it really clear really quickly which one's going to work better.
What are the tools do you use?
Yeah, great question. On tools, everything we looked at tonight was done in Excel. I use Excel for almost everything because it's still what most of my clients use. There are a lot of different tools out there. Tableau is certainly increasingly popular. My view is that the tool is never going to get you 100% of the way there, because the tool is never going to know your story. That's where it takes coming in and doing all of the sort of changes that we talked about tonight to making that story clear. There are some tools that will start you off in slightly better places. I always thought I should make an Excel template that, where I make all of the changes that I make every single time, and always use that as a starting point, that I would save so much time, right? Take out the grid lines, put it in the color scheme I want. And I finally created the template. You can download it on my site if you're interested. But I find personally I don't use it, because for me, starting with the ugly Excel graph and figuring out how do I make this show what I want it to show has become part of my process. But that's a good point, which is that it is a process and it takes time, because your tools will, for the most part, not spit out exactly what you need, which means that it takes time to get it there. But it's time well spent when it means the difference between getting your message across to your audience or not. So it's 8:15. I'm guessing people want to get home. Is that a fair assessment? Awesome. All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming out for the video. Yep.
So thank you very much, both.
Thanks.
It was great. Everyone, please, you're welcome also to wander over. You can see the work of John's been working really hard after the last hour and has captured some serious highlights. We're going to take some pictures of that and put them on the meetup site, but you're welcome to take your own pictures, ask John questions, whatever you want to do. Certainly, Cole's going to be here for a couple more minutes if you have any more questions for Cole. Please take a cookie that you guys can take and eat or a drink. We got drinks left over. And I need volunteers for June. I need volunteers to come up here, plug in, and just demo either a software tool or a website that you use to visualize data for like 5 minutes. Just show something pretty simple, but it's meant to be a group activity. So thank you very much. Thank you, Cole.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.